upstairs into you know, clubs and the like. And we ended up finding something like that, and then and I found the right kind of microphones to use, and that got us out of trouble in the end.
I'm going to preface my next question by a quick story I heard. It was a group that had come and played, and I think in Missouri somewhere, and it would have been a horrible night, and only five people showed up in the crowd. And the lead singer came on stage, and he says, "You people brave this, and you came to hear us play, and we're not going to disappoint you." And the five people applauded. He said, "So for our last song..." So when we come back, I want to hear a little bit more about some of the strange places you might have played, and possibly the tour in Japan in the 60s. Don't go away. We'll be back with more Mike Pinder.
Floundering in your current watering hole, then wet your whistle at the Clipper.
Sometimes you wanna go where everybody knows your name.
The Clipper, Long Beach's number one draft choice, with 11 different draft beers, 6 satellite dishes, and 15 monitors, making a front row seat for your favorite sporting events. The Clipper has incredible edibles and the best CD jukebox in town. Or make your own music Saturday night with karaoke and $1 shots. The Clipper, where everybody knows your name.
As the holidays draw closer, our thoughts turn to visiting family and loved ones. Touch of Travel will be pleased to make these reunions a happy occasion, with professional service, lowest prices available, and free delivery. Whether it be airlines, Amtrak, hotels, car rentals, or cruises, Touch of Travel is with you all the way with our toll-free number in the U.S. and Canada. Touch of Travel is your travel advisor, and our staff lives and participates in the community. For a holiday you'll always remember, call us at 427-2144.
The time, sorry.
He believes what he wrote, so he hasn't got the time, he's leaving. So that you remarked, you've never seen that clip?
I've never seen that clip, no. That's interesting.
Where is it from?
I have no idea. Not at all. I mean, maybe
was
Beat,
it you?
Beat Club? BBC Two? That was me. I thought it was Elvis for a minute, but.
But it looked like it was in a club. Where did they get that? The Inner Glen? I'm sorry?
Beat Club? BBC Two? BBC Two?
BBC Two?
Beat Club, yeah.
Okay, that was a big popular show then,
yeah,
in England.
It was very underground at the time. It was the second TV channel in England. They've only got 4 now, I think, anyway. But
they're all wonderful, too, every one of them.
Mm-hmm.
I was going to do this interview, similar to London's interview. So you did you? That's it.
Sort of.
Sort of?
Sort of.
Didn't you sometimes...
Absolutely, old
I
chap.
Hope so.
Ready, set, go.
Ready, steady, go.
Yeah, ready, steady, go. I'm sorry.
Favorite,
ready, steady, go.
Favorite
big show.
Big show, and we sort of became regulars on the show because we lived in town, London, and we were available most of the time, and a lot of people didn't show up from wherever they were coming, and
it was one of those things where,
yeah,
well,
these guys didn't show up,
get over here and play.
I remember we did one of the Christmas shows. We used to do a lot of live things there. And one of the Christmas shows, we intertwined I Go Crazy, James Brown number, da-da-da-da-da-da-da, you know that one? And we put Jingle Bells right in the middle of it. That was interesting. And another Ready, Steady, Go, which is the one that really sticks out in my mind, was when with that beautiful Steinway grand piano, I think it's about 10, 12 feet long, and we were doing What I Say.
Ray Charles
number. And there was a big podium, a long podium all around the back, and there was Smokey Robinson and the Miracles on the podium. And then we had, there was us, the Moody's, I was on the piano, and on top of the piano was the Supremes, the three of them, standing on top of my piano, and we're all doing What I Say. Then that's a piece of footage I'd like to see.
Oh, maybe we can dig that up. Somebody have that?
No. I hasn't been released by Dave Clark yet or something. Or
does he own the rights?
I believe he owns all of that stuff.
Didn't they run Ready, Steady, Go on one of the cable channels?
Disney.
Ran Ready, Steady, Go. I remember watching that.
That's just down the block here.
Yes, it is. Right, yeah. There with the little mouse.
Yes. Doing well.
I heard.
Rumors, all rumors. Moody Blues. How many of you know how the name got started? Well, you're no fun at all. There's a lot of people that know how it got started. Well, for some of you, who doesn't know how it got started? You don't know how you got here.
I know he has two jobs.
He does. Tell us about Moody Blues, the name.
A lot of times it's been written up that it was specifically made for a brewery called Mitchell's and Butler's, whose initials were M&B. Now, this is somewhat true, except that, in fact, my mother ran a hotel, a large pub, that is, for Mitchell's and Butler's. And Mitchell's and Butler's also owned a lot of very big pubs with assembly rooms and dance halls in there. So a lot of gigs were available, you know, and so we were trying to tie something in with the brewery so that we could tap them for a couple of £1,000, you know, for some promotional money and also try and get, you know, onto their circuit. So we were kicking around, you know, what to do about a name. It was Ray Thomas and myself were in an office with Phil, who was our manager at that time. You know, we thought about this M&B thing. That was not, we were talking about
so
it.
So you
at
had
the time.
Letters. We had
the letters simply because, well, it was M&B, you know, was, well, can we target M&B, you know, for a couple of £1,000? I'm going M&B in my mind, and I'm thinking, you know, my favorite stuff. What are we playing? What am I interested in? I'm interested in mood music, you know, and one of my favorite pieces was Mood Indigo. And so I got the mood, so Moody, okay, I got that, and then we needed a B, and we were playing R&B and blues, so Moody Blues, you know, came very, very easily.
Anybody say, nah?
No, actually.
Wouldn't that have been something?
No. I like that.
It was a go.
Yeah, Ray said, yeah, I like that. And we said, well, what about putting 5 on the end, Moody Blues 5? And, yeah, okay, we'll go with that.
Dave Clark 5, Moody Blues 5.
It lasted about 3 weeks, and
about
we dropped 5.
When you go back in time and you see the success that the Beatles had, as a musician and as somebody who knew them, played with them in a way,
yes,
were you fascinated with the way they grew and that whole thing that just took off? Did it amaze you?
It didn't surprise me because of the sheer raw talent that they had. You know, I look back on the Beatles as, and I still look at them now in the same way, because there's no other way that I can really see them, as almost like four adventurers that discovered a castle, if you, a magic castle, if you will, that had this incredibly long hallway. And down this long hallway were doors to the left and doors to the right. And they went down here saying, wow, look at this, and opening each door, opening it wide, flicking on the light and going, wow, look what's in there. Mm-hmm. And then they'd go to the other door, and they went all the way down this hallway. And occasionally they would stop in one, and that was a piece of music, you know. And they went all the way down this hall, opening all these doors, and then guys like us came in afterwards and went, wow, look at this. And we found one door and said, hey, let's go in here. And that was the Moody Blues. And then there was, you know, the Rolling Stones and the Searchers and the Who. And that's the way I always visualize it.
So that.